This conference will now be recorded.
Okay, so today we're going to see data preprocessing by using Titanic dataset. I'm already mentioned you the link of the dataset in the chat box. Try to copy that link and load that dataset with respect to that code, that link. So it is a CSV kind of file. So Titanic.csv, it is having some kind of extension, .csv. What does that .csv stands for? Let me know your responses in the chat box. Yeah, it is a comma separated values. So that it is having extension like .csv. And what is the difference between Excel files and CSV files? .xlx files and the CSV files. See, both are same, but as compared to CSV, Excel files will take more memory to store it. Yes, it takes less memory. CSV files can take less memory to store it, or to store the values of that particular data. We can use mostly CSV because it takes less memory as compared to Excel files. Now, the first step, we need to import pandas. So with respect to that pandas library, we are going to load that data set. So it is a CSV kind of file. So we need to take the variable to store that data, that is df here. I'm taking df is a variable. With respect to that, I'm going to load my data set. So for that, we need to use pd.read_csv, and then you can mention the data set link. So with the link, you can load the data. So after loading it, you need to display the first 5 rows. How can you define, how can you display that first 5 rows? By using head method, right? So it will give you the first 5 rows of that given data set. So this is the one way to loading the data set, and we have some other way to load the data set. So that is, you need to copying that link, you can open that link in any browser. So it will open some kind of data like this. So if you want to maintain this file in your local system, you just select all the content, and try to copy it in your respective folder. So the today's folder is day 27 in data preprocessing, right? So there you need to take new text file. Okay, if you want to copy this Titanic.csv file in your local system, you need to copy that entire data and open a text file from your folder. So today folder is day 27. Then in the right side, you can able to get a text file option, right? So click on that text file and mention the entire code that you copy. Copy that entire data that you have copied, paste that entire data. Okay. So after that, you just rename this file name that you want, whatever it is. I'm already copied that with titanic.csv. So titanic.csv. Okay, I have already a name with titanic.csv so that I can take a new file name, that is titanic1.csv. You can mention any other name and click on OK. And make sure this file should be saved. But here you cannot able to get observe it is saved or not. So if you want to save this file, just go to the file option and then click on save. Whenever you click on the save, it will automatically raise a tick mark on that file link. So then only it should be saved properly. Otherwise you will not get to observe this file while loading. So try to save this file. And after saving it, you can observe that respective file in your folder. So you can able to get the Titanic1.csv in your day 27 folder. So if you want to access this Titanic.csv file in your Jupyter, you can use it like again, pd.read_csv. Then you can mention the file name that you want. So we have a Titanic file dot, right? So we have already saved this Titanic.csv file. So when you mention the first 4 letters or first 2 letters and then give tab, so it will automatically display the Titanic related files. So out of those, you can pick up any one. Okay. And then you can display that first 5 rows by using head method. Then you can observe same. The data should be the data set is same. So first, initially we are loading the data set with respect to a GitHub repository link, like HTTP GitHub repository and AP stage skill development. So with the help of a link, you can load it a data set like this. And also, if you want to make that file, if you want to store that file in your local system, you can just open this link, and after opening the link, you just copy the entire file data, select Control A and Control C, and then you need to take a new text file in your respective folder where you want to store it, and then click on text file. After clicking on text file, it will open, and there you need to paste your entire copy data and save with whatever your name. After saving it, you can load it by using read_csv, and then you can specify the name that you have, titanic.csv. Then it will automatically load the respective data file. Like this, you can load the data set. So the first way is by using link, you can load the data set. And the second way is you can download that file in your folder. Then you can load it with the file name. Okay, am I clear how to load the data set? We have different ways. So the first way is by using Google link or any other link. So when you use this link to load the data set, you need to make sure your system should be connected with the internet. Then only it will work to load this data set. But sometimes you don't have internet connection, but we want to load the data set. In that case, how can you do that? Means you just make that you just load the data set in your local system, and you can load it by read_csv. For this step, you don't need any internet connectivity because we have already there this titanic.csv file in day 27 folder. So it is not required any internet to run this, to load this data set. Okay. Am I clear, students, how to load the data set? We are already discussing this type of process, but am I again repeating you for you? Respond me, it is clear. Loading the different data sets, different formats. What about rest of them? I got only 3 responses. Okay, good. So now the first step is completed. That is the first step, taking the data or loading the data. So what is the second step? What is the second step that you want to perform? After taking the data, if you want to work with your data, what is the second step that can take place? After taking the data, what you want to do? Yeah, you should do some kind of pre-processing, right? So in the pre-processing, we have say different steps to handle with to do some kind of pre-processing. You should know the different steps that can exist. So what is the foremost step in the pre-processing? I'm looking into your responses. What is the foremost step after taking the data you should do? Checking null values. That means you should know some kind of statistical information, right? So how do you get the information about the data set? You need to analyze the data. So what is the method that you have to know the information about the data set? I'm asking you about the information. So if you want to know the information about the data set, that means how many rows and how many columns and what are the data types that can take by the every column. So for that, you should know the information method, that is info, right? So the second step is finding the information. About the data set. So how can you find out the information of a data set? Yeah, we have a method that is dot info, right? So data frame dot info. We have already loaded the data frame with respect to df variable. You can mention like df dot info. So it will gives you the information regarding the data set. So here you can able to understand how many rows and how many columns that can take place. And here you can see totally it having 891 entries. That means it takes totally 890 rows. So 0 to 890 means totally it have 891 rows. And how many columns? Totally it having 11 columns. Okay. And you can able to observe the supporting data types that can take place by every column. So total that 11 columns is here, and after the 11 columns you will get some kind of information like how many null values are there, non-null values. That means there is a some kind of data. So null values means there is a NaN values. Non-null means other than none there is a value. Those can be called as a non-null. Now you can see every column that might have some 891 rows, right? So all the data should be like some null values, and it can display you some kind of data type. So it will display the data type stores by the every column. And if you see out of the 11 column, what are the features that they have object data? What are the features that they have object data? You can specify the numbering instead of column name or feature name. You can specify the numbering. What are the data? What are the columns that they have object kind of data? Yeah, so totally you can at the bottom you can understand data types. Totally we have float and integer and objects. So total float type of data we having two columns, two features, and the integer type of data we having four columns, as well as object data type is having totally five features or five columns. So like this you can understand. So after taking the data, you need to analyze the data. What are the data types that can stores by every data, and how many rows and how many columns, and how many null values are there. So by seeing that, you can understand which columns are having some null values. By seeing the info of data set, you can understand some of the features might have some null values, right? So out of the 11 columns, which columns do you think having the null values, most null values? So instead of passing like is null, you can understand how many null values are there. So you see totally we have 891 rows. So 891 rows means in the survived there is totally 891. So they didn't have null values, and also in here also p class also doesn't have any null values, and a name also doesn't have null values because it have totally 891 rows. And if you see the age, it have only 714 values. So that means the age column should have only 714 row values, the rest of rows. So out of 891, it having only 714 values. The rest of values is having some kind of none values. And also you can understand here fair also having, so fair doesn't have, and also cabin. So cabin also having 204 values. The rest of the features, rest of values are null values. Out of 891, the cabin feature having only 204 values. The rest of features, the rest of values are null values. And embarked also having 889 values. The rest of values are out of 891, it having 889 values. The rest of values are null values. So like that, by observing this data information, you can understand what are the data types that can store by every column, and also how many none values, and how many non values, and what are the types of data, and what is the memory allocation, and totally how many rows and how many columns. Okay, so based on this, while seeing the information, you need to understand. So based on this analysis, you need to understand it can takes only, the machine can takes only integer type of data to do any kind of pre-processing or deployment, anything. If you want to develop any application, the machine can understand only integer format of data, either zeros or ones. That means back end there is a process to confirm it, convert it, but basically it takes only integer data. But out of these 11 columns, you can understand totally it having five columns having some kind of object data. That means object data means what type of data that having, what is the type of the data storing. Yeah, object data means it is a kind of string type. So yeah, it is a kind of string. So you need to convert that string type. If you want to use this column, if it is useful to your application, you need to use it. Otherwise, the machine cannot perform well, because if you delete that feature, it cannot perform well if it is important feature. So in that case, if you we need to use it, but it is a type of object. In that case, you need to convert this object type into integer. That means we are typecasting our data from one object to integer. So you should know how to perform a pre-processing. So if you take this Titanic dataset, out of this 11 features, what do you think what is our target and what are our inputs? In your prospection, what you want to find out finally based on this Titanic dataset. So it having survived, plea class, name, sex, age, sibling, patch, ticket, fare, cabin, number. Out of the columns, which column do you consider as a output or target? What you want to find out at finally? Yeah, I got one response. What about rest of them? You can respond me any other options. That's not a problem. See, while taking the data, you should know what are the inputs. Based on the inputs, what you want to predict. Okay. You should know what is your input and what is your target. What is your input features and what is your target feature. So based on that only, you're going to train or apply data science application. So when you take this Titanic data set, it is a Titanic data set. Basically, we are taking whatever the data that we have. Out of the given data, we should find out either the person is survived or not after traveling into a Titanic. So we need to figure out either person is survived or not. So the target is survived. That means we need to find out either that person is survived or not. To find out that person is survived or not, they might take some other features like a person, traveling class, name, sex, and age, and SBPS, and patch, ticket, fare, cabin, embark. So this is a one kind of data set. Some others already generated. Some other person will generate it. So they have developed this kind of data set. So in their perspective, they all consider the rest of features like class of the passenger, class of the name of the passenger, age of the passenger, and ticket fare, ticket and fare, cabin, where it is, which cabin they are traveled. So they are considering these are all the features. So based on these features, they want to predict either that person is survived or not after traveling in Titanic. So they are developing a kind of projects to do this. And why we need to find out that person is survived or not means, so in the next class, if any other person, dead bodies came into the sea, we need to figure out based on the features of like person, class, age, and sex, if the person died with the having similarities of these kind of features, we will the machine can predict either person is survived or not. Okay. So if they already died, they will tell the machine will tell you like zero. If the person is if the person dead body we are not getting means we need to figure out if the person is survived or not. So machine learning or data science applications means we need to predict the future. In the future, what is going to be happen? As a human, we cannot tell them tell that the future may be like this or like this. The machine can tell us. For that, we are training some kind of data science applications to machine. So we will work out this data Titanic data set in future in machine learning algorithms also. So you will get more clarity. But here, for doing pre-processing purpose only, we are taking this data set because it having so many null values and it having some kind of so many object type of columns, so that you can understand how the pre-processing can take place when you take the data set. Okay. So basically, when you take the data set, Titanic data set, we need to find out the target is survived or not. That means here we are taking target output data is survived, and we are considering the rest of features as input. Based on these inputs, we are training a model, any mission. We are training one mission. So based on the training, it will predict that the person is survived or not. That is the purpose of machine learning. In upcoming days, you will get more clarity about that. But you just focus on the pre-processing here. So after finding that information about the data analysis, you will come to a one conclusion like there may be a possibilities of null values, and there may be a chances to convert a typecasting of object to type integer, because the five features having some kind of object data, if the features are suitable to our application, that means sex is important to our data set, because based on sex we need to figure out which gender persons are died or not, survived or not. So that is here we are considering sex is a one kind of important feature to check that a person is survived or not. And also if you take name, so name is doesn't required when it comes to survived, when it comes to check with survived or not. So we are going to remove it. But sometimes we need to check with the feature type. So if it is important to our application, we need to typecast that object data into our into integer format, so that we can use that particular feature to develop our application. Let's see one by one how to typecasting it. And after finding the information, we are going to see the statistical information about the data set. Okay, so if you want to know the statistical information about the data set, how can you find out? Because we are already discussing about that. If you want to get the statistical information about the data set, you can use df.describe. It will give you the statistical information about the data set, like mean value, median value, standard deviation, and 25% of data, all these things. Okay. Now, if you see the count, the first statistical information, we are getting count as a result. So it will generate the statistical information for every column. So the count of survived column is totally we have 891 rows, and in the P class also having 891 count. Age is having only 714 count. The rest of count is related to null values. So like this it will generate. So I'm coming to mean. So if you see the survived column mean, it will generate some 0.3838. And if you see the P class mean, it is having some 2.308 something. So like this, you will get to observe some kind of statistical information, and you will get some kind of minimum value out of the every column. So if you see the survived feature, the minimum value it is having 0.00, and the maximum value is 1.0. Based on this, you can understand. So the survived column having the values either zeros or ones. Not only either zeros or ones, the minimum value is zero and the maximum value is one. That means you can understand the values of survived takes place in between 0 to 1 only. And if you see the P class values, the minimum value is 1 and the maximum value is 3. That means you can understand there may be a passenger classes either 1 or 2 or 3, because the minimum value of P class is 1 and the maximum value of P class is 3. So in between that only you will get the values in the P class column. So like that, and also you can observe the age of the age minimum value is 0.42 and the maximum value is 80. So that means which age people can travel in the Titanic means you will get one understand. That means 0.4 years, if 4 months babies to 80 years people can travel. So based on this age you can understand like that. So when you use describe, you will get some kind of statistical information like this. And after that, you need to do a pre-processing. So that means we are up to now, we are checking the information about the data set and we are getting some statistical information about this. And now we need to do a pre-processing. The first step, we need to do a pre-processing. Before that, you should know the columns of the given data set. So when you give dm.head, you can understand the first 5 rows. You will get the first 5 rows. But out of this, I want to get the columns of a data set. How can you get the columns of a data set? If you want to get, or if you want to access the columns from the given data set, how can you get it? Yeah, by using df.columns, you will get that columns from the given data set. So now you can see the columns from the given data set. Totally, we have 11 columns. And those columns are like survived, peak loss, name, and sex and age, and all those things. Now, out of this column, you need to understand the type of it. And if you want to see the count of the values, you can see it. Now, if I want to access that survived column, you can give df of survived. So df of survived will gives you the entire values. Totally, it will generate 891 values. But out of those, if you want to get the values count, then you can use value underscore counts is a method. Then you can understand, it will generate the count of that every value in the survived column. So totally you can understand, totally it having only 0 and 1 value. That means it is having only two classes, either 0 class and one class. If it is 0 class, means the persons is not survived. 1 means the persons are survived. So totally if you see, the count of 0 is more as compared to 1. That means totally 549 people are died out of the 891 persons. Okay, so the count of dead people is more as compared to survived. Not survived people count is more. So based on this, you can understand totally how many values there, and with respect to that values, you will get to observe the count of that values also. And if you want to get this sex values, that means if you want to access this sex column, how can you access? And if I want to access that values count inside that sex column, how can you get that? Do it and let me know. How can you access that sex column values count? These all steps comes under pre-processing only. See, the developers who are developed the Titanic dataset, they will assume like they are already tells you some kind of description while developing a dataset. So in the bottom, they will describe some data information. 0 means the persons is not survived. 1 means like the persons are survived. So we are not justifying it. Either 0 means survived, 1 means not survived. They are assuming like that. So based on that, they will give you some kind of count. So you can understand the description about the data set. So in Kaggle or some other platforms also, they will provide you some kind of description. What value will, what signifies. Okay. Am I clear, students? Accessing the survived column counts, value counts. Getting error means just check again. Had you load this data set with df variable only? Imran from ALTS. See the method, yeah, it is method is values underscore counts only. After typing it, I'm just giving shift tab, that's why the method is repeated again. The method is value underscore counts. Then you will get the count of that values from the survived column. Now it's your turn to access the sex column and get the values of that sex column. Yeah, you can access it by df of sex, and then you can mention value dot value underscore counts. Then it will give you the count of that sex values. So totally in the sex we can observe there is two classes. One is male and female. So the category male is having totally count is 577, and the female count is 340. Okay, like this you can access any particular column, and based on that column you can get the values also. You can get the count of that values also. And also if you access this embarked, so let's access that count of that embarked as well. So df of embarked, and then you can pass value underscore count. Now we will get in the embarked, you can observe there is a three columns, three features that we have. It is S and C and Q. So there may be some kind of description for this every value. So S means some kind of description. I don't know exactly what it is, but it is having three, that is S and C and Q. So in the S, they might have 644 count. So with respect to C, totally it has in 168 count, and count of Q is 77. Like this, you can access any column and you will get the count of it. So if you want to get the unique key elements from that, no, it S means not survived. It is not signified survived. There is a classes, I think so, not exactly. So if you want a description about the data set, I will update the description after the class. Don't worry. Which value signifies what, I will update the description. Now, if you want to get any kind of unique elements, like we have one method, like accessing the after accessing the column, you can specify unique. Now you will get the unique elements from that embarked column. So totally in the embarked column, you can have totally 891 rows. Out of the 891 rows, if you want to get only unique data from that embarked column, you can give dot unique. Then it will give you the unique elements from that embarked column. So totally in the embarked, you can have S and C and Q is a unique elements, and also NAN. So these are all the unique elements that is having in the embarked. If you want to get the unique elements from sex, you can access it like df of sex dot unique. So it will give you the unique elements from that given column. See, out of the sex, you can have unique elements. Those are male and female. And also, ticket is having some kind of. Let's see the description about the ticket. Ticket is having 891 and it is a kind of object. Let's see the ticket unique elements as well. TF of ticket dot unique. So in the ticket, you might have some kind of data. So every it will gives you only unique values, but it is having a totally 891 as a unique data. So you will get some kind of array when it is accessing. So age is also integer. So you might get unique, but it is huge. And cabin. So cabin means what it is. Cabin is having 204 non-null, and it is a object data. So based on the application, you can access the unique elements. Okay. So now, so if you see the data frame once, out of the given data frame, what are the most features that are useful to your application? What do you think? Which features are most useful to you? So when you see this data frame, you can see the columns as survived. So survived is important. Basically, we need to figure out either survived or not. So with 0 and 1 values, so it is an important column, and P class. So P class also having some kind of 1, 2, 3 classes and name. So a name is not an important feature to find out either person is survived or not. When it comes to Hughes data, we are not requiring name. So based on other features like sex and age and some kind of ticket fare also, we're going to find out either person is survived or not. But name is not an important feature, and sex is also important. So based on gender, we need to figure out which gender people are mostly survived or not. So it is an important feature. And age is also important. So based on age, which generation people or which age people are mostly survived or not survived or not, we are going to figure out. So in that cases, age is also one of the important, and SIP-SP. So I don't know what it is exactly, but I was thinking it is not important feature. So name, SIP and patch and ticket. So that ticket also not important for us. And based on our application, so it is not mandatory to consider all the features. So out of the given features, we can pick up one best features. Yeah, I'm going to tell you why name is not important. So if you see, the name is kind of object. Here, if you see, the name is a kind of object. It is a string data. And if you want to pass this string data to machine, out of the 891 rows, it is not important feature. Why I'm telling you that? So based on name, so that is not a factor, because if you see here, it is having 891 rows. So you might think it is a less data, so you can figure out of the name, you can figure out based on the name which people are survived. But what if you have so much of data, like some 40,000 rows and 11 columns? So in that cases, we are not perfect. We are not taking that name as a best feature to find out which person is survived, because based on gender, so based on gender or based on age, based on ticket fare, we can find out which people are survived. Okay. So because name is a kind of object data, and it is, if you want to use this name, you can use it. But the name should not be same for 891 rows, because 891 people have their own names. In that cases, if you want to pass this name as also input to your machine, you need to convert these names, 891 names, object data, into a type of integer, so that the machine cannot consider this type of Hughes data as an integer. Cannot consider this kind of data. So we can consider some other features to predict either person is survived or not. So it's up to you. But basically, we are not considering name as a best feature to find out which people are survived. And the ticket also, we are not going to consider it. And fare, we can consider it. And cabin. So cabin also, we are not going to consider it. If you want to consider it, you can use it. It's up to you. So we are. You should know. You might already know how to get how to access a columns and which features are helpful to your application. Based on the application, you can consider the features that you want to use it. Okay, and also embarked. So out of the given columns, I don't want this name column and this SIB SP column and patch and ticket. Okay, I don't want these columns. Totally 1, 2, 3, 4. And cabin also. So this cabin also I'm not going to consider, because which features we are not going to consider means basically the features which is having more null values, we are going to drop it without seeing it. But in some cases, that the column should be useful to our application, but that they have some kind of null values, means we are going to consider it by pre-processing the null values, by filling the null values. Which features we are going to remove it means which features that they have some kind of huge null values, we are going to remove it. But if in some situation that might have a that feature might have a useful to your application, means in that case you just replace the null values of that particular feature and you can use it. Okay, so now let's see how to drop these particular columns out of the given 891 rows and 11 columns. So we have a D of dot columns like this. 11 columns we have totally. Out of these 11 columns, I don't want this name column and SIB SP column and patch and ticket. So let's remove it. If you want to remove any particular column, remove Features. Here, the feature columns can also called as a features. When it comes to machine learning terminology, you can call that all columns as a features. Okay. So whatever the features that doesn't require to your application, and if the features are having more null values, you can simply drop it. Okay. So for you can remove it. So that is the next step you are going to handle. Remove features is the next step. Here features can also call columns. So for removing features, what is the method that we have? If doesn't require this sex column, or if doesn't require this name column, means how can you remove it out of the given columns? Yeah, you can use drop method to remove any particular columns. So the method we have is drop, to drop any particular columns. Now let's see how to drop a group of features. So while dropping, d of dot drop of. So if I want to remove this name, I can mention name like this, and as well as name. So I want to remove this SIB SP column as well, and parts column as well, ticket as well. So that means I have a list of columns that I want to remove from my data set. In that case, how can I pass the drop? How can I pass all this list of elements to drop method? When it comes to single feature, you can drop it like this, by passing like this. In the parenthesis, you can specify single column. But we have too many columns. In that case, how can you specify that columns in the drop method? By using indexing. Yeah, by passing it as a list, you can drop it. So whenever you have more features, you can specify that features in a list. Okay, name, and then SIBSP, and then part, and then we have ticket. You can specify all of the columns in a particular list, and then if you remove it, if you run this, you will get one kind of error, that is key error. So these are all keys we have presented in the data frame, but when you drop it with the particular names, you will get this name SB patch ticket should not found in your access. But we have these columns with respect to names in data frame, right? But why we are getting this kind of it is not found in the access error? Whenever you find this not found in access, means what do you think? Because we are getting it right. So it is not the machine or this should not find out which access this having. So defaultly, when you mention drop, it will checks with row wise. So it will checks with the data that you passed with row wise. But we have this name SB patch ticket column names as a columns, right? So when you have a drop method, it defaultly drops the row wise data. But sometimes if you want to remove any particular features as a columns, you need to specify the axis over here, because what axis it point out the column. Defaultly drop takes the axis equals to rows, axis equals to rows. But if you want to specify, if you want to drop any columns with respect to columns, which axis do you want to pass here? Yeah, you need to specify axis equals to one. Then only it will checks with access equals to zero, one means it will checks with the column, and it if they find any respected name of key, it will remove. Now you can see that particular name column and SB, SP and patch and ticket column should be removed from your data set. Okay, can you able to understand up to this? So after this, if I found a df dot, okay, after dropping it, if I want to, so after dropping it, I just want to get the first five rows instead of all. You can get only first five. So now you can see, after dropping it, if I give df dot head, you will get to observe this name and these columns again, but we are dropping in the previous cell, right? If I run this again, you can observe name and patch and ticket columns again. Why it is not updating in the data frame, because we are removing it. After removing also in the main in the data frame, it doesn't change. The name column and SBIP column, batch column, can also visible to you. That means that is not deleted in your data frame. So if you want to make changes in your main data frame, you can pass in place equals to true as a parameter. Then only the changes, the dropping elements should be dropped from the main data frame. Defaultly, this in place equals to in place parameter is having some kind of false parameter. There you can see the in place equals to false. Defaultly, this in place attribute is having the value is false. That's why the dropping result should not be reflected in your data frame. Now after dropping it, if you want to reflect any changes in your main data frame, you can pass in place equals to true. Okay, then you can give df dot head. Then you can see the main data frame, you are not getting any kind of name and SB patch ticket columns. Like this, you can remove any particular columns that you don't require. Okay, if you don't require any particular columns, you can remove it by using drop method. Now if you check with the information df.info, then you can see it is having totally 891 rows and it is having only 7 columns, because we are removing 4 columns out of 11. Those are name, SB, patch and ticket. After dropping it, if you give df.info, it will tell you it is having only totally 7 columns, and at the bottom you can understand, you will get to observe that 7 columns. Like this, you can remove any unwanted columns, unwanted features from your given data set. Okay, that is the first step. That is the step we have done in the previous. After dropping unwanted columns, we need to work on our wanted columns. So now we have a columns like df.columns. Now you can see it is having totally 7 columns, that is survive, P, class, sex and age and fare and cabin and embark. So out of those, out of the columns, you can understand. So if I consider survived is my target, so it is already in the integer data type. So I don't need to typecast it because it is in the format of integer. And if you see the P, if I consider the rest of features as my inputs, as my features. So based on my inputs, I want to figure out either person is survived or not. So I want to check with my output. So now let's see the features. So we have a P class in the format of integer and sex is in the format of object. It is a type of object. It is having a data type is in the string, so that you can understand it is a type as a object, and the age is also in the floating point. So machine can understand integer and floating, not a object. If you want to use that any particular object data in a data set, you can typecast it object to type, object to int. And you can see cabin and embarked also a kind of object. So before typecasting it, you need to handle that null values in any column. Out of the given columns, you should handle the null values out of the given columns before typecasting any data type. So if you see this is 7 columns, out of the 7 columns, age is having some null values, and also cabin is having null values, and embarked also having null values. Okay, now let's check the null values. How to check in null values? Check null values in a data set. That is the next step that we want to perform. If you want to check the null values in a given data set, how can you find out? After filling the null values with proper data, we can typecasting that object data into an integer. So if you want to check the null values, how can you check it? Yeah, we have a method to check it, that is isNull. Now let's find it. If I want to check the null values in my data set, I have a data set with the variable of df. So you can give df dot isNull dot. So if you give isNull, it will tells you wherever it finds a null value, it will tells you a true. So wherever it finds a null value, it will gives you that a true as a data in that particular column. And instead of that, I want to get the count of sum of that null value, we can give sum. So it will gives you the sum of the null values count. It will gives you the sum of the null values with respect to every column. So out of the given columns, you can understand totally in 177 null values in the age column and 687 null values in the cabin column, and 2 is a null values in the embarked column. And what is this cabin data? Let's see once. Cabin also having object data. And if I access df of cabin, it is also having some kind of object data with some kind of alphanumeric data. So it doesn't require this alphanumeric data. So this cabin column should not refer to us. So we need to remove this cabin column also, because cabin column also doesn't have any proper data. So that is not helpful to our application. So we just doing with the pre-processing. So when it comes to application, we are going to typecast. We are going to consider all the data and we are handling with all the data. Instead of name, we are considering rest of all features. Now, if I want to remove, so here itself, I want to remove this cabin also because we don't use that. There is no proper data. I'm going to insert a new cell here. If I want to remove that cabin, I can give df.dropper. There you can mention cabin and x is equals to 1. And also you need to reflect the change in the main data frame. So you can pass in place equals to 2. So now you can see totally it having, after dropping cabin, you will get to observe only 6 columns, and you cannot get that cabin column because we are removing it previous. So after that, if you give df.columns, it is having totally 6 columns, survive, p class, sexer, age, and fair and embark. And after of those, if you want to handle the null values, you can give is null dot sum. It will gives you the null values count. So totally we have a null values in the age column like 177 and embarked column as a 2. Why I am removing cabin means it doesn't have it doesn't require any proper format, and because it is having some kind of alphanumeric data, and if you see it is having some C85, NaN, NaN values. So out of the given features, so out of the 11 features, we have a mostly null values in the cabin. We have a mostly null values in the cabin. So the foremost step you need to handle, you need to do means whatever the feature that having most null values, that going to be removed. Why? Because it is having null values mostly, and also that is not suitable to your application. Based on that requirements, you can remove that particular column. Okay. So this cabin is having more null values as compared to 11 columns. The cabin is having 687 null values. That means you don't require the data. When it has the more null values, you can simply remove it. Okay, and now if you check the null values count, you can observe age is having 177 and embarked is having only 2. So we need to fill these null values with proper data. And if you want to fill the null values of the age, how can you fill that? So because age is important, instead of removing the null values of the age column, we can fill that null values with proper data. Because when you remove it, the entire row should be, the entire row with proper along with the NaN value should be removed. That means we are losing some kind of data when you remove that particular null values. Instead of removing that data, we are going to fill that null values with some other data. So now if I want to fill that age column with some kind of null values, if you want to fill it, you can use df of age dot fill NA. In that case, you need to understand which value we need to fill this age. On what value we want to fill this null values of age? Do you think, or what do you think? On the basis of which value do you going to you are going to fill that null values of age? So when you see the age column once, it is having some kind of float data. Yeah, it is having some kind of float data. So but whenever you want to fill the null values of that age, how can you fill it? If you fill this age of null values with 1, is that correct format to fill it? Or 0, you can, if you pass, fill any of 0, or fill any of one means it is not a correct format to fill that age none values, but you can see the values inside this age column. So it is having some kind of float values. It can minimum value is minus 0.40 to 80, right? So in that case, you can go to calculating the mean of it, and you can fill the mean with respect to none values. You can fill the none values with respect to mean of the age. Okay, so now let's see how to fill that null values inside the age column, df of age. Based on the values, we are going to fill the null values. If it is having in the age having, if you see, is there any kind of two or three values, you can fill it with either zero or one. But age is some kind of continuous data with having 0.0 as a minimum value, 80 is a maximum value. In that case, you can calculate the mean of it and fill the null values. Okay, so df of age dot fill na. If you want to fill the null values with mean, how can you fill it? Fill any of, there you can mention the age column, and you can calculate the mean by dot mean is a method. Okay, so now entire null values, the null values of the age column should be filled with the mean of the age column. Now if you check the df of is null dot, so after filling the null values in the age column, now let's check again some of the null values. So now if you see, it is not going to be changed. Again, we can able to see this 177 as a null count. What are the changes do you need to pass it here? We are filling it with here, right, in the sixth place. Yeah, we need to reflect these changes in main data frame. For this, you can pass in place equals to true. Then only this null values of age column should be filled with the mean of the age column. After running it again, if you check the null values count, now you can see in the age column you will not get any kind of null values count. It is related to zero because we are already filling this null values of age with the mean of the age column. Okay, like this you can fill the null values of any particular column. If it is a age, means based on the values of that particular column, you need to understand which value we need to place it while filling the null values. Okay, am I clear, students? Filling the null values of age column. Respond me. Can you able to follow the class? See, at any point of time, if you don't understand anything, you can respond me so that I can explain entire steps again. Okay, so we are filling the null values in the age column, but when you see the mbarc, it is having some kind of two null values. So we want to fill that null values of mbarc also. Now if you see the data inside that mbarc, we are already seeing that mbarc data, mbarc values, it is having some kind of values like SCQ, right? So this is SCQ, we're already seen it by UEQ method, SCQ and also NAN. So that means it is having some kind of object data. So if you want to fill the null values of this embarked column, we need to fill either these values, either S, either C or either Q. Okay, so it's up to you. Now let's fill the null values of embarked column. So for that, df of embarked dot fill any of, there you need to fill null values of mbar with, so I'm just filling the null values of mbar with the yes quote. So this is like here, all the values is like capital, so I'm passing yes only. So instead of that, you can use mod also. So okay, let's see, I'm just calculating the mode of these embarked ones in the previous cell. Let's see the result. If it is fine, I'm going to replace that mode method here. Embark dot mode. If I pass embark dot mode, so it will gives you mostly as a Z. Yes. So you can use mode by calculating the mode of the embark, or you can fill the null values. So you can specify fill any of df of embark dot mode, and you need to reflect the changes in the main data frame. You can space, you can specify in place equals to true. And after replacing, after filling the null values of embark, let's find out the null values count again. Is null dot sum. Why it is not reflecting? If I make in place equals to true also, I am not getting this embark. You will get again embark null values count is 2. What is the thing we have done here? But for me, it will gives me only 2. See again. See, I'm already checking with that, right? So it will check the it will give you the mode as 0 and yes. Mode of the type of it. If I give type of so it will returns the pandas series type. Okay, when I use df dot embark dot mode, it will not reflect the changes in data frame. So for that, instead of this mode, I am just using let's run this null values count cell in new cell. Yeah, okay. So whenever you pass this, it will not reflect the changes in main. So try to run this cell at initial time. After running it, after filling the null values with embark mode, you just run null values count with a new cell. Then only you will observe the changes. Then you can see in the embark you will not get any null values, and you can see a zero as a count. That means we are done with handling with null values. We are done filling the null values with all columns, and you can see there is no null values in any column. So next we will see converting object data converting object data type features into int. Okay, see, in the previous what I am done means while filling the null values in embark, I am run this is null cell count in the same cell. Like here itself I'm writing that, so that's why it will takes it doesn't reflect the changes. That means so it takes time to run it, and when you mention this is null sum within the same cell, it will not reflect the change. so that I'm just mentioning it. When it runs, it will not reflect the changes. So that I'm just mentioning is null count sum after filling the null values in this new cell. By taking a new cell, I'm just find out the I'm going to mention this is null dot sum by taking a new cell. So that you can understand, you will get to observe embark count as zero, embark null values count as zero. That is the error that we got. So it doesn't error. So the changes cannot be reflected in our main data set. In that cases, try to run this in your new cell. So filling the null values should be run in a new cell, and count of the null values also you can run it in a new cell so that you can understand the result easily. Okay. So next pre-processing step means after handling with the null values, we need to working with the pre-processing step, that is converting object data type into any other format like either integer or float. So why we need to convert object data type? Why we need to convert object data type? So because the machine can understand either integers or float, it doesn't understand the string format of data. So that we need to convert any string type of object into another. So now let's see to convert any kind of object. So df dot info, let's see df dot info. Now we can see in the df dot info, we have object type of columns is sex and embark. We have totally two columns with the object data. Those are sex and embark. So we need to typecast it. So for typecasting, to convert this in to convert this object data into any other integer or float, we have methods to convert it. So the first method we have is, we are generating some kind of dummies data to that objects, get dummies, by using get underscore dummies. Yeah, we can make that male as a zero or female as a one, but it is not possible to typecast that manually. As a user, we cannot do that manually. So for that, we have a methods. So the first method we have is get dummies, to create a dummies for every data in that particular object data. And so when you use get dummies, so it will generate a new columns for every feature value. It will generate a new column for every feature value. So so that means it will generate a new column for every feature. So that is not a proper way to do a kind of data set pre-processing. So to overcome that, we have some other methods, that is label encoder, or we have one hot encoder. There is no spaces in between this. We have a methods to do this. Okay, by this you can simply, instead of generating new columns, it will automatically generate a label. Based on label, it will encode the value into either integers or float. Basically, it will typecast it like integers only, object data into integers. Let's see one by one. So we have, so df of sex is having some kind of object data. Let's see what are those. So it is having some kind of male and female. If you want to get unique element data, you can give df dot unique. So it is displayed that it is having totally male and female. If you want to get the count of it, we have already done all these steps in the previous. Count of it, you can give values dot values underscore count. Value underscore counts. Now you can see male is having 577 count and 347 count of female there. So we need to convert this male as a one kind of integer data, and again this female as a one kind of integer data, because the machine can understand only integer data or floating data, not object data. So for that we can use get dummies method. So for the get dummies method is having in the pandas. So pandas dot get dummies. So now we are already importing pandas. For better understanding, I'm going to import this pandas as pd again. So while generating a dummies, so that means we are generating some kind of dummy data for this object data. So now let's see how to generate it. While creating a generating a dummies, I'm using d1. D1 is a one variable, to generating a dummies, and we are just storing the result with D1 variable. So PD dot get underscore dummies. When you type PD dot get underscore dummies, so now you can see it will take some kind of attribute, that is it will take data as a default one, and based on that data it will create a dummies. So we need to specify the data that you want to create a dummies. So we want to create a dummies for the object data type of columns. So we have totally two columns which is having object data type, that is sex and number. So first let's see how to create a dummies for sex column. So that I can mention here the data is sex. So this sex will get you from the df. So df of sex. Again, if you see the D1, after getting a dummies, if you see the D1, you can see it will generate some kind of two columns. It will generate two columns. These two columns we are getting from the sex column, right? We are getting inside the sex column, you can understand, you will get a two values. Those are female and male. When you use get dummies, it will create a two features, two values, two columns. Those are female and male separately. And you can understand it will generate totally either 0 and 1, because totally in the sex column, we have two values. So based on that count of the values in the particular column, it will generate the dummies. So we have in the sex column, it is having only two, so that it will generate either 0 and 1. If it is having some other gender, that means either A, B, C, if it is having A, B, C as the sex values, so it will generate dummies as 0, 1, 2. Okay, it is having only two, those are female and male. Based on the length of it, it will generate. So now if you see the result of male, it is having some kind of zeros and ones. And what you think zero stands for and one stands for? In the female or male, you can understand it is having some kind of combinations of zeros and ones. And what do you think this zeros and ones stands? Yeah, it is obviously binary values, but what it is, what it signifies? Yeah, one means true. Okay, one response. And what about rest of them? It is obviously zeros and ones is a binary values, and one means like true. But here if you see the in the sex column, we have a female and one. We want to get finally we want to get the result, like we need to assign for all the males. Let's take, if I want to convert all the male values, male data into a one and female as a zero, in that case we need to get either zero as a male or one as a female. Right. That means we want to get either 0 or 1 to create a dummies. But when you give get dummies, it will generate say zeros and ones along with the each specific column. So zero means inside the whenever it having female in the sex column, in the female data, for the female data, it will generate zero as a signification value. And whenever it find out the male as a result in the sex column, that defines that signifies as a one. Okay, so inside the sex we have female and one. When you use get dummies, it will generate say a value, it will generate a new column for every value. In the female, if you see the zero, so zero means it will wherever they can find female as a gender in the sex column, that will denotes as a zero. And wherever it find out men as a data in the sex column, there in that places it will automatically generates that value as a one. So like this here also, if you see, one means it will generates male as a one, and zero means it will signifies the zeros as a female. Okay, that means it will generates based on the sex column, wherever they find a female, so female will be assigned with the values of zero and male will be assigned values of one. But instead of generating in a single column of sex, it will generate new column for every value in that particular column. So inside the sex we have two values, those are female and male. So while creating a generates, do you think sex will be getting as a zeros and ones only? But instead of that, it will generate value as a column. Okay, replace method can't be used female as well. Let's see. I'm not sure. Let's try out. Okay, by using replace also you can do it. I think so. But before that, we need to access it, and instead of out of that entire accessing, we need to figure out where we get male, where we get female. So after getting that, we can figure out. So df of sex. Let's try it. Df of sex dot replace. So there we need to mention which value to which value we need to replace, right? So if I mention female to one in place equals to true. Let's see, is that reflecting changes or not? Yeah, you can use replace also to replace any kind of method. So when you have one or two or three, you can replace it. But when you have a much more data, it is not possible to create it. It is not possible to replace it. So in that case, you can use getDummies method. Okay, we have alternatives. Based on that, you can apply any one thing. So by using replace also, you can replace it. But this replace can work for either one data or two data or three data or four data. What if they have a huge huge values of object data? So like 10 or 11 or 12. And that feature also important to our application. In that case, you can use getDummies to instead of replacing every particular value. Okay. Okay, now let's see if you use get whenever you use get dummies, it will automatically generates a new column like female and male with respect to sex column. Now I want to add this d1 into my data frame. So for that we can use concatenation, right? So while concatenation, I am using df1. So pd dot concatf, there you can specify iterables. So we need to add data frame with d1. So d1 is our get dummies method. So we have a dummies in the d1, and we need to add this dummies into our data frame so that I can use df comma d1. And then if I print, the result should be stored in the df1. If I give df1 dot head, instead of getting the values, it will generate some kind of null values, NaN values, right? But we want to get the values like either 0 or 1 in the female or male. So we need to specify the value here, I think. So, comma df of. Type error. Sorry. Here we need to specify the column. Thank you, DF. So DF should not be changed. In the df, we are applying a replace method. So in the, wherever the female came, that value should be replaced with 1. But when I concatenate df of comma d1, when you give df1 dot head, so there you cannot get to observe the result. It will replace with NaN values. Why? Let's see the method once. Access equals to 0. Defaultly, it will generate access equals to 0. Bypass comma access equals to 1. Yeah, you need to specify the axis. Otherwise, it will generate row wise. It will concat in can it will concat the values by row wise. If I remove D of, yeah, now you can able to see. You can able to see while concatenation, you need to specify our data frame, comma dummies after creating the dummies variable. So and then specify the axis. Otherwise, it will generate dummies with respect to row wise. In the row, we cannot have female and male values, so that's why it will generate defaultly NaN values. Okay. So if you mention the x equals to 1, you can understand wherever the male getting in the sex column, that will be replaced with 0 value, and wherever the male getting, that male value should be replaced with 1 based on sex column of the main data frame with df variable. Okay. So when you use get dummies, you can concatenate it with main data frame. Like this you can perform, but when you concatenate with main data frame, instead of reflecting the changes in the sex column, it will generate, or it will reflect the changes by taking a new columns, right? When you use concatenation method after generating a method, when you use get dummies method, so it will generate the dummies based on value of that particular column. It will generate new column as a value of that particular column. So that means when you add that columns into your main data frame, the length of the data frame is increased. So it will add two more. So that's why it is not a good to do a kind of applications to do a pre-processing. So instead of that, we want to reflect these changes in the sex column only. Instead of generating a new column as a female or male, so instead of generating a female male as a new columns, we want to reflect these changes. Whenever you find a female as 0, female should be replaced with 0 and male should be replaced with 1. We want to reflect that changes in the sex column only. Okay, so for that, instead of using get dummies, you can use the inbuilt pre-processing methods. Those are label encoders or one hot encoders. Okay, so instead of generating a new columns as a data, we can use the inbuilt method so that the changes should be reflected. The data should be transformed, whatever the values that we want to pass. Based on the values, it will transform in the same column only. In the same column only, like in the sex column only, we are going to reflect the changes instead of generating a new columns. And in the embarked column only, we're going to reflect in the changes instead of generating a new column. Okay. Okay, do you clear what is the thing here? So when you use get dummies, so it will generate the values as a new column. Based on the column, it will generate the values as a new column. So it will increase the size of the data set, and the changes should not be reflected in the same column as well. So instead of generating a new columns, we need to reflect the changes in the main column as well. Like whenever you find a female, we need to reflect the changes female as a 0, and we want to replace this male as a 1 instead of generating a new columns. So that we can use inbuilt pre-processing methods. Those are one hot encoder or label encoder. Okay, so let's see. Let's see how to perform that. Instead of get dummies, we can use one a label encoder is a method. So why means we I'm already tell you, get dummies will generate a new features as a new columns, features feature values as a new columns, so that we can reflect the changes in the main column. For that, we can use label encoder. So this label encoder and one hot encoder should we get in sklearn preprocessing. Those are packages from sklearn, so we need to import it. So for importing, you can use sklearn.preprocessing. So these steps are comes under pre-processing. So we can use the methods like from sklearn.preprocessing. From there you can import it, the label encoder. Label encoder. Okay. By using label encoder, you can transform whatever the object data into your labels, into your labels of either integers. Okay. So you can import it like this. After importing, try to create an object for it. Try to create an object. So while creating an object, I am taking a variable name as le equals to label encoder. So le equals to label encoder, and try to pass a parenthesis at the ending so that it will point out it is a kind of class. We are creating a class object for this. So you can create a dummy, you can create a sex column after generating a dummies. Instead of using female, male, I just want to use sex column only so that I can keep this sex column, and I don't want this female and male. If you want to remove it, you can drop it by using drop method. Okay. You can remove it, this sex column, after creating female, male columns if you want, but I don't want that. I just want to reflect the changes in the sex column only. I don't want to generate a new columns. So for that purpose, I'm using a label encoder. So after creating a label encoder object, so try to pass. Yeah, label encoder is a package which is came from sklearn preprocessing, so that you can import it like from sklearn.preprocessing. So I want to reflect my changes in the sex column, so I can mention as df of sex equals to, I want to reflect the changes in main column, so I can give like df of sex is equals to, we need to transform the data, so with the uses of label encoder. So we have already created an object for label encoder, so you can use le dot, you can transform it by method of fit underscore transform. So fit underscore transform is a method so that it will transform all the object data into a particular range of data. So fit underscore transform, while transforming, you need to mention which data do you want to transform. We need to transform our object data of sex column, so you can specify that to fit underscore transform of df of sex. Okay, can you understand what is the thing here we are doing? So I am doing a label encoder. By using label encoder, we are converting the object type of sex data into integer. So for that, I am just using label encoder. So importing label encoder is completed, and after that, I am creating an object for label encoder. After creating an object encoder, after creating an object, you can use object dot fit underscore transform so that we can transform our data into integer. We can transform our data into integer, and in the parenthesis you can specify what data do you want to transform. Okay, we want to transform this sex column data, so that you can specify df of sex, and finally we want to reflect these changes after transforming the data of sex. We want to reflect these changes in the main sex column so that I can specify df of sex equals to. Okay, like this you can specify mbar could also, because mbar could also have some kind of object data. And after transforming the data with label encoder, I want to store it in the embarked column only, so I can use same column name. Le dot fit underscore transform is a method to transform the object data, and inside that you can specify the type of data that you want to transform. I want to transform embarked data. Okay, I got error. What it is? Type error. Str init. Strings or numbers, what integers? Yeah. See, in the sex column we have I'm done replacing with female in the previous cell, so that when you access sex column, it will raises an error. What is the error means? In the sex column, I'm already replacing this female with one value. That means we are passing sex column data. When it passing, it is having some kind of integer like one, and also string like male. That's why it will raises in a type error. So what should I do now? That means it is already reflecting in a main data frame. So let's replace again. Let's replace that one of female into female again, because my main data frame is changed here. For that, I'm importing new cell. So df of sex dot replace of. Replace, if I want to replace one into a female again, and I need to reflect the changes in main data frame so I can use in place equals to true. After replacing one into female, let's see that data frame again, df dot head. Yeah, now we can see in the sex column, you can have only male and female. Okay, in the sex column, we have only male and female. So now it's work fine for label encoder. Again, encoder sort method str. So it is a kind of method. So let's see the type of this sex column once. Df dot info. See, when you see the type of df is sex is having some type of integer, it is not an object, so it raises an error because we are already replaced that female value with some other integer, so it's automatically changed. What should I do now? L dot fit underscore transform. Strings or numbers code method comes str. In the embark, we have only object data, but while encoded, it inputs to be informally strings or numbers. It is having only values like S, C, Q. Mode of zero. See, previously, while filling the embark null values with mode, it will fill the null values with some kind of mode, right? We are filling the null values with some kind of mode of embark so that it will consider that it is a kind of methods we are passing while encoding. See, it will generate some kind of methods. When you give values, you will get the result. Okay. Let's do one thing. While filling the null values, we are filling that embarked with mode of it. That means it will defaultly generating some kind of integer before it. We are already seeing 0, yes. That means along with method, it will generate. So that it will not sortable. So if I work with df of, so sex also having some kind of integer. So before that, before applying a label encoders, let's try to load the data set again. Because the inbuilt data set is changed. So the main data set is changed. So for that, I'm just loading the data set again to show you how the label encoder will work. So df1 equals to pd dot read underscore csv titanic dot csv, and then give you df, so df1 here. So totally we are getting all those things. So out of those, I want to drop that unwanted columns, df dot drop of. So let's do again all the things because the data set is changed here. So name, df dot drop of name, and SIBSP and ticket and cabin. And what else we want to remove? Yeah, we can use list patch also. When you have a list of features, you can pass like list map format, access equals to one, and then in place equals to. And df dot head. There is a spelling mistake, I think. So where it is, name, SIBSP, and ticket, cabin. Yeah, sorry, it is a df1. Thank you. After removing it, you can have only survived, B class, and sex and age and fare and embark. Okay, now let's fill the null values if it df dot age of df of age dot fill any. So we are going to fill the null values inside the age column. So fill the df of df1, it is df1 of age dot mean, and in place equals to true. And then we have null values in df of embark. So we are going to fill the null values with only either a string, because when you fill the null values of embark with mod of it, the label encoder will raise errors. So to overcome that, we can fill it with any string. So I'm passing s as a, let's take n. N is a, let's pass yes, because when you calculate mod of it, so s is having s is getting the result. So for that, I'm just filling that null values of embark with s, and then you can reflect with in place equals to true. It is a comma. Unmatched fill any of S. Okay. fill in your quotes and then increase equals to 2. Okay. Now let's check d of 1 dot is null dot sum. Now you can see there is no null values in the data frame. Now we are going to apply info. df1.info. Now you can see sex is having object data and ember could also having object data. We are going to convert it by using label encoder. So for that, let's import label encoder from sklearn.preprocessing. Import label encoder. So create an object for it. I'm using le is a variable. So df of, I'm going to reflect the changes in main column, so I can use same variable name. So le dot fit underscore transform. Then you can specify the column that you want to transform. And then you need to change with ember code also. Le dot fit underscore transform, and you can specify the info and bar. So it is a df1. Okay, now you can see df1 dot info or df1 dot head. Now you can see all the sex column and embarked column should be replaced with integers. So this job is responsible for done by label encoder. This job is done by label encoder. So based on the length of it, it will automatically generate that values. So if you want to see it, you can see df1 of sex, and then you can pass value underscore count. Then you can see all the one is represents that it is kind of male or female. Male, and zero represents that female. So like that it will change based on label encoder. The data should be transformed. Okay, instead of using get dummies, you can change it. And also we have seen some problems, right, while using label encoder. So you can use any kind of the label encoder can convert or can transform the data, so which is having only string data, not methods. Okay, so that means while transforming the data, you need to take only columns which is having object data. Float is doesn't require to typecast it. So the machine can understand either integer and float. So we don't need to typecast it. Object only we need to typecast it. And if you see the df1 of embark dot values. So totally it having either 0 or 1 or 2. So that means if you want to get the individual values count, you can use value underscore counts. So you can have totally two e stands for yes, and 0 e stands for c, and 1 e stands for q. So based on the data, it will automatically transform it. So these are all the steps comes under pre-processing only. So we need to analyze the data. Okay, so now if you see the df1, so if you see the df1, the range of survived column is 0 to 1. The range of p class column is like 1 to or 0 to 3. The range of sex column is 0 to 1. Again, age is far away from the others, and also fair also should not familiar with the rest of the columns. That means the every column should have their own magnitude, and age and fair column data should be not in the same range as compared to survived, p class and sex and embarked. So if you give statistical information like describe you can understand. So here you can understand the sex column and age column and fare column should have more range. So the age count is like 891 and the minimum value is 80 in the age, and the minimum value is 0, maximum value is 80, and in the fare also the minimum value is 0, the maximum value is 891. So that means the range of values are different as compared to other columns. So in that case we need to scale them into a one range. We need to scale them into a one range, because when you see some of the columns, that columns data should be not in the same range. So we want to scale them into a same range so that we can use scaling techniques, like that is also come under data preprocessing, scaling the features in the we are going to apply the standard scalars for this data set. So we are already seen all this in yesterday. Now let's apply this all the scales for Titanic data set. So let's import all the scales in single cell, sklearn.preprocessing, import standard scalar, and from sklearn.preprocessing import min-max scalar, and from sklearn.preprocessing import, what else we have, robust scalar, and from sklearn.preprocessing import normalizer. And let's create an object for everyone. So for standard scalar, I'm using S is a object, S equals to. So standard scalar. You can give a tab so that you can get all the methods. Instead of typing entire thing, just give tab. And for min-max scalar, I'm using object with variable of m. I can give a tab and you will get that. And for robust scalar, you can give R is a variable, R equals to robust scalar, and try to create for 4. And for normalizer, you can give N is a variable to create an object and a normalizer. Okay, try to import all the scaling methods in single cell. After that, so we want to scale down all the features in the same range. Okay, by using standard scalar, it will follow the mean and standard deviation. It will calculate the all means and set the mean as 0 and standard deviation as 1, so that it will arrange the all features with that same range. And min-max scalar will follow. So standard scalar will set the mean as 0 and standard deviation of 1, so that it will generate the scale down the values and min-max scalar will generate the values in the range of, you already done that is today, minus 1 to 1 if it is a negative values, or else 0 to 1 if it is having only positive values. In between 0 to 1, it will generate, it scale down the all features. Robust scalar basically follow the interquartile range. So based on that, it will generate the values, scale down the values, interquartile range, IQR range. And normalizer basically work with the row wise, and it is also generates in the row wise and scale down the features like 0 to 1. In between 0 to 1, it will scale down the features. Now let's apply all the features to this scales. So for transforming all the features, for transforming S1, for transforming all the features with standard scalar, I'm using S1 is a variable. And let's fit the data. S dot fit underscore transform. So fit underscore transform of. There you can specify all the data. We have a data in the variable of df1. See, it will take only 5 more minutes. You don't worry. I'm not taking much more time. Okay, we are transforming entire data frame with standard scalar so that the data should be standardized with the help of standard scalar. Now let's standard, let's use min-max scalar. So for that I'm using m1, m1 equals to m dot fit underscore transform. Then you can specify the entire data. We have a data in the variable of df1. So next we will, let's standardize with the robust scalar. So r dot fit underscore transform, then you can specify the data. And next we have normalizer. So for that I'm using n1 is a variable, n underscore fit underscore transform, and you can specify the data that you want to transform. See, all the data should be fitted with along with the proper methods. And if you want to visualize it after scaling down, so if you want to visualize it, you can use matplotlib so that you can get more clarity. Matplotlib dot pyplot as PLD. Okay. Next, initially I'm going to plot a box plot. Box plot for before scaling. Before scrolling, I'm using df1. Instead of all data, I want to own plot. So then I can use plt.show. And I'm applying some kind of title it. Title equals to before scaling. So it will generate a box plot for total columns. We have totally in the DF1, we have totally 6 columns. So it will generate data based on. So here, if you see, the data should be varies from 0 to 500, up to 500. Now let's plot for after scaling the data by using standard scalar. So for that, we have already done with S1 variable. So plt dot box plot of. Box plotter, there you can specify the standard scalar data. So we have standard, we are done standardization with S1 variable, so you can specify that. And this is about standard scaling after applying standard scalar. You can see the plot. So after applying standard scalar, so based on mean value as 0, standard deviation 1, it will apply all the, it will plot it like, it will scale down the features up to minus 2 to 10. Every feature should be scaled down by using standard scalar. Then you can plot it, you can observe. So in this plot, you can see these dots. These dots can be called as an outliers. So these dots is far away from the remaining data. So when you can observe some kind of dots, so those are all dots can be called as an outliers. So outlier is a value that is far away from the actual values. Okay. And now let's plot for RoboScalar and MinMax Scalar also, so that you can understand the difference, how the values are scaled out. So MinMax Scalar object is we have in M1 variable, and you can specify it after applying MinMax Scalar. MinMax Scalar should be scale down the features from 0 to 1. So now we can see after applying MinMax Scalar, so the values can be scaled down from 0 to 1. All the feature values should be scaled down from 0 to 1. All the features, we have totally 6 features. All the features is scaled down from 0 to 1. So like this, you can get the box plot for MinMax Scalar. Now let's apply with RoboScalar also. So RoboScalar object is we have in the variable of R1. So this is about after applying RoboScalar. So RoboScalar will based on IQR range. IQR range means interquartile range. So all the data should be lied between the 20% to 50%. So like that, it will scale down the data from 20% to 50% range. So now you can see when you path the RoboScalar, you can see the all the data should be lies between 0 to 20. The values of all features should be scaled down from 0 to 20. So now if you use normalizer also similar to MinMax Scalar, but MinMax Scalar will work for column wise. The normalizer will work for row wise. When it is a clustering, we can mostly scale down that clustering using MinMax normalizer. So we have a normalizer object with N1 variable. So you can use N1 and after applying normalizer scaling. So the normalizer also will scale down the values from 0 to 1. All the values should be scaled down from 0 to 1. So before applying all this, scaling techniques, our data should be lies between 0 to 500. Before applying scaling, all the features have lies between the values of 0 to 500. And if you apply scaling for this data frame, if you apply standard scalar for this data frame, all the values are lies between 0 to 10. Based how it is happen means defaultly there it calculates the mean and standard deviation. So mean should be deleted. That means the mean value is going to be arranged like 0 and standard deviation can be arranged like 1. So based on that, it will scale the all features of six features into 0 to 10. And if you apply the data frame, if you apply MinMax Scalar for the data frame, the all the values of six features should be scaled down from 0 to 1. And if you apply the RoboScalar for the data frame, all the six features value should be calculated based on IQR range, that is from mostly 20 to 75%. So based on that, it will generate all the values between the range of 0 to 20. Okay. And if you apply normalizer, it will based on it will also generate the values between 0 to 1. All the values should be scaled up from 0 to 1. Okay. Can you understand the difference between all the scaling techniques now? Basically, this normalizer will work for clustering techniques. So every row can be taken, while normalizer will take every row. Instead of feature, it will take row, and final result should be displayed with respect to column only, feature only. Okay, that's it about the today's session. So if you have any doubts regarding the today's class, stay back in the meeting and unmute your mic and try to ask me so that I can clarify you. Otherwise, you can leave the meeting. Thank you and all.